you. Guys, I just came from Liverpool, yeah? And on the train, okay, fans of the Scouser. Okay, I'm going to talk about your people. So on the train, this guy sitting opposite me, sitting in silence for most of the journey, then he randomly goes, "You're the exact kind of girl I fancy. You're the exact kind of girl I'd like to date." And I was like, "What kind of girl's that?" And he was like, "A strong black woman." And that kind of scared me. I'm not going to lie, not the black part, but why do I need to be strong? Like, what are you planning on putting me through that requires strength? So I was like, "Sorry to disappoint you, but I'm not a strong black woman." Black, yeah, obviously, but strong, I've cried 3 times today. The strongest thing about me is my hairline. Sorry. Anyway, he started laughing in Scouse and and he was like, "You're dead funny." And I was like, "I hope so, because I'm literally on my way to a comedy contest." And he was like, "Oh, me mate's a comedian, but he's like dead unique because he's autistic. He's autistic comedian." I didn't know how to tell him, "Your friend is not as unique as you think. Like, most of the comedians be having the tism. Even me, I got diagnosed last year by a doctor, not TikTok." Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, I was shocked. Not to sound ignorant, but I didn't think black people could catch autism. I didn't. I thought it was a white people thing, like sunburned. But yeah, I wasn't interested in Mr. Train Guy. I was actually dating someone in Liverpool, but I made it weird a couple days ago. Can I tell you about it?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, right, I'm a virgin. And when I'm dating a guy and I want to let him know I'm a virgin, I like to let him know through song, because why not? Do you want to hear a bit?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll do a little bit. "Do you want to enter this vagina? First, you got to put a ring on my finger. I won't free it up easily. Exclusive punani." I mean, I got a Caucasian version as well, if that will go down well. I don't know. Anyway, so, right, I went on a date with this guy. It went really, really well a couple days ago. He was going back to he's in his car. He has a car. And do you guys know that song, "Wet Ass Pussy" by Cardi B?
Yes.
Great. So that song was playing in the car and this man's shoulders were going. So I was like, "Oh, do you like that song, yeah? You like the freaky girls?" And he was like, "If she ain't a freak, I don't want her." And I was like, "So what, you wouldn't date a virgin?" And he was like, "Girl, I'm 32, I don't have time to be dating virgins." And I thought, okay, this is probably a good time to sing my song. Don't know what happened though. I got stage fright. I didn't want to scare him off with my hymen. 15 minutes later, fast forward. I don't know why I did that, oh my God. Anyway, we're in his house. He has a house. And we're in his living room, making out on his sofa. He has furniture. And it's getting a bit like, you know, and then I started to panic because I realized I have not told this man I'm a virgin. So I excused myself to his bathroom, the one that he doesn't share with housemates because he owns his own house. And I started thinking, what am I going to do? Because, like, I like him. I'm really into him. But I can't just go out there and, like, have sex with him, because if I do that, then I have to change the lyrics to my song. But then I thought, maybe I can. And I do feel a little bit embarrassed. I'm not going to lie, but I'm just going to say it because we're all grown-ups. I thought, I'm a grown woman. Maybe I can... You're going to make me say it, fine. I thought maybe I could lick his willy. Because then, like, we can, like, be somewhat intimate without me having to change the lyrics to my song. Anyway, I've not done that either, but I just thought, you know what? My best friend, Champion Willy Sucker, still in the bathroom. Her words, not mine. I text her, and I was like, "Girl, can you give me some advice? I'm in the bathroom. I'm about to lick Willy for the first time. I don't want him to know I'm a beginner." She was taking too long to respond, and I didn't want this boy to think I was having a poo. So I just thought, I'm just going to go out there, and I'm just going to try my best. Right, so, okay, we're making out on the sofa. This is the most embarrassing part, so I'm going to tell it really quick, okay?
Yeah.
Tell me to slow down. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
We're making out. it's got to the point where Willie's out. It's time for me to do the performance of my life. So I sort of just, I'm here. And I opened my mouth to, and honestly, I don't know why this happened. I don't know how this happened, but I just, I started singing to his penis. And he was like, "What are you doing?" And I was like, "I'm just warming up my throat." And, you know, I haven't seen him since. And bye.
Hello, friends. How you doing? Good stuff. I'm going to start my set off with something very shocking for you. I actually don't like Oasis. If your Oasis heads in. Look, I got a bit of a... this is fun, isn't it? I got a bit of a does have a job, but does do a bit of heroin on the side kind of vibe. That's what I'm going for. I'm going for train spotting with a pension plan. I got a name for this look. I call it a delinquent accountant. It's not really a joke, but it is fun to say, isn't it? Some of you may have noticed I'm a very bony fella. I'm a very angular man. Ex-girlfriend of mine once described a cuddling up with me as a cuddling up with a tote bag full of coat hangers. And it's out of order, isn't it? It's so out of order. And when someone says that, you got to be seen to be doing something about it. So I popped to the gym right now. I don't know if anybody here goes to the gym. If you don't, let me save you a little bit of time. I'll save you a little bit of money. It's a house of the sea. All right, first thing you see when you walk in my local gym is a big motivational slogan on the wall. It says, "Nobody ever said I regretted that workout." First thing you see, walk in the door, "Nobody ever said I regretted that workout." 6 feet along, on the same wall, defibrillator. Not fooling me, guys. A lot of liars in the gym, a lot of liars in fitness, fashion. You guys know there's a hiking brand called Trespass? Yeah. There aren't many rules in hiking. In fact, I say there's one thing you're not allowed to do when you're hiking. It's like having a swimming brand called Heavy Petting, man. I see a lot of people wearing Gymshark. I think it's very noble of a brand to step up and say, "We'll label the predators in this arena." Says a lot about you what you wear, doesn't it? Gymshark, I'm a predator. Nike, I love children. Who work 18-hour factory shifts. Adidas, bit of a legend. That's what I heard. I don't know. I don't go to gym no more, man, because it's boring. I get my exercise walking my dog. I love walking my dog because you see things when you walk the dog. The other day, I witnessed a couple have their very first kiss. I could tell it was a first kiss because it was very clumsy. It was very awkward. I was getting closer towards it, and I noticed it was one of those kisses where both people involved had forgotten everything and everyone else around them existed. She had a hand on his chest. He had a soft hand behind the ear. And as I walked past them, I said, "Oi, oi!" I appreciate your laughter, I really do, but just to let you know, shouting oi, oi at kissing couples is in fact a very important part of my culture. I consider myself ethnically Cockney. It's a very serious term. It means I was born in the East End of London to a family who are from the East End of London. But when I was a little boy, we moved out to somewhere very exotic. It begins with a Z and it ends with an X. If there's anyone well-travelled in, nobody ever gets it. Zone 6. We moved out to Zone 6, man. That's a cheap gag, isn't it? I'm a son of a bricklayer and a dinner lady, right? And they're both refusing to let go of their working class identity. Yeah, my dad came around my flat the other week and he said to me, "Who the fucking hell do you think you are?" After opening up my fridge and seeing a jar of pesto in there. I said to him, "Dad, 8 mile, I'm looking after it for a friend." He didn't believe me, man. He tried to sit me down and make me the whole thing in one go. It was awful, man. It was awful. I live in South East London now. I love living in South East London. It's nice and rowdy. It keeps me on my toes. I got on the 177 the other day. Schoolboy at the back of the bus goes to me, "Oi, bruv, you look like an ugly Jared Leto." And yeah, yeah. I mean, look. I think I got more of a CBBC Super Hands thing going on. But, you know, what do you say to a 14-year-old kid after you kicked him in a fucking sternum? It's very tricky, man. It's very tricky. My local high street, Deptford High Street, was recently voted London's coolest high street. It was, unfortunately, by Time Out magazine. It's a bit like getting a spud off your nan after you've had a threesome, isn't it? It's not sexy anymore, Nan. It's not sexy anymore. I started working in Knightsbridge recently. I'll tell you this last thing before I go. There is absolutely nothing funnier in this world than a posh person expressing sadness at a minor inconvenience, right? I got out of Knightsbridge station the other day. I heard a bloke on the phone and he went, "Did you hear about Jonty? He lost a testicle." I said, "Oi, oi!" Thank you for listening.
All right, governors, we good?
Yeah.
So, I found out that Apple have made a thing in Hollywood where it means that like only the good guys have iPhones. So if you go on Android, you're a fucking evil, innit? You know what I mean? Yeah. If you got a Huawei. Fucking devil, innit? That's what I mean. Just... Any Huawei dons in the room? Okay, keep it to yourself, innit? Your secret's with me. Okay, okay. My name's Ibs, which is spelled IBS. If you didn't look me directly in the eye, I know you got IBS, innit? Don't. It's a nickname, and I think it's a good nickname, you know what I mean? Yeah, because it's shorter than my actual name, yeah? I have a friend named Femi. His nickname's Fems. All they've done is change a consonant to a vowel, or the other way around, isn't it? And I thought vowels were good, innit? A-E-I-O-U, good ones, isn't it? Like, if anything, his name should be F. Like, that should be his nickname. Whoa, go on, F. Long time no see. It works. It works. Short for Ibrahim. Yeah. And yeah, I'm a part-time Muslim. Come on, a few other part-time Muslims in the room, you know what I mean? It's one of them ones where it's like, I like getting hammered, but I don't eat ham. It's one of them ones, yeah? Do a bit of raving, do a bit of Ramadan, innit? You know what I mean? Yeah. But I love a bit of pepperoni, but I don't have a foreskin. Balance. Like, that's my G, you know what I mean? And some people don't even like clock on that I'm like Muslim because I'm black, like so much so that a man came up to me and was like, "See that black man over there talk about Islam? He's not allowed because black men are not allowed to speak about Islam." I was like, first off, you're speaking to a black name, man named Ibrahim. Yeah, that's second thing is, I don't like the way he said Islam. It was a bit like, what's in that casserole? Islam, like, do you know what I mean? I don't. Doesn't even make sense, man. But like my dad said, yeah, it's like, Islamophobia is bad, but having four wives is good. Big man, four wives. During a cost of living crisis. I'm gonna take my chances, I'm not gonna lie, I'm gonna take my chances. Because if you've got four wives, you've got to love them all equally, yeah? Buy one of them a bag, they're all getting a bag, yeah? Buy one of them a house, they're all getting a house. Give one of them an orgasm, she got to keep that shit to herself. We don't want dissension in the ranks, you know what I mean? And I always get told, like, why don't you speak Arabic, any Arabic? And I'm like, auntie, uncle, I'm dyslexic and dyspraxic. The fact I'm speaking Arabic, and the fact I'm speaking English, sorry, alhamdulillah, man, I'm trying my best. I'm trying my best. And I've also got visual stress as well, so... Basically, all I need is ADHD, and I'm an additional needs Thanos, innit, yeah? Thanos with an F. That's an F, yeah? But I'm not using them terms. I prefer to address myself as a neurodivergent Negro. What? Because it makes me sound like a superhero, you know what I mean? Like, I'll be flying here like, neurodivergent Negro, fly to the left. I'll fly to the right, like. Like, I don't even know if I got my right or left correct. That's how fucked up my shit is, yeah. They'll be like, neurodivergent Negro, what's your kryptonite? Scrabble. All I can do is swear words or add SSEO words, yeah. I'm so neurodivergent, and when I got hacked on Instagram, everyone knew it wasn't me. And then when I asked them why, they're like, the hacker was replying back in perfect English. We knew that shit wasn't you, yeah. They saw tomorrow with two R's and they were like, this Negro's in trouble, he needs assistance. Immediately, yeah. And I understand that some people may feel uncomfortable with me saying the word Negro, I get that. But I feel like we can all collectively think, yeah, that the term neurodivergent black man doesn't have the same je ne sais quoi, like, you know what I mean? Yeah, you know what I mean? And I'm using alliteration. After what I just told you, the fact I'm using alliteration, you lot should be proud of me, I'm not gonna lie, I'm doing bits. Thank you, thank you. Double alhamdulillah, yeah, like. And I could have said another word beginning with N, let's be honest, yeah? And that word is 7 points on Scrabble, yeah? Yeah? ER, 8 points. ERS, 9 points. However, the word white, 12 points on Scrabble. The game's rigged, bruv! That's what I'm trying to say. Some of you don't think I'm still talking about Scrabble. Anyways. So, like, I've started dating. Yeah, man. Yeah. I went on a date with a girl from Newcastle. Any Geordies in the room?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm about to chat shit about you lot, innit? Don't worry. Quick time. Okay, we'll talk about underwear. Yeah, could have got like that. Yeah, you know what I mean? Sometimes it gets like that. And then she said the word knickers. Which in most accents sound like underwear. But when my girl said it, sound like 9 points on Scrabble, not gonna lie. Not gonna lie. I'm trying to make her my second wife as well, man. It's bare peak. I'm not even saying. I just wanna say that if I don't win tonight, just know that the judges, two of them got Androids, innit? One of them, yeah. One of them got a Huawei, innit? Yeah, that's been me, I've been Ibs.
That's him, ladies and gentlemen. Give him a round.
Good evening. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, wow, shit, this guy has an oily face. Well, that's because I put some oil on my face. So if you were expecting some self-deprecation based on a flaw in my immediate physical appearance, jog on! And to the people pondering that I do in fact have a very oily face, behold the palm! See how it gleams with a lubricant that also doubles as a massage oil. Now, since this is a final, let me also address why I'm trailing three sheets of toilet paper from the heel of my right loafer. Again, this is no accident. I saw Harry Styles rocking this look in Sidcup Leisure Centre. I'd just come out of a legs, bums and tums class and my goggles were foggy. But I'm certain it was Styles. Although, holy moly, that lad has put on some weight! Back to the face! At this point, the MC will be concerned about the transference of lubricating oils to the shaft of the microphone. But the hand which clasps this mic is as dry as the Taklamakan desert. Because, as an erotic 45-year-old gay man, I have been forced to perfect the judicious application of lubricants. Now, as your response conclusively proves, to the people I've brought with me, I'm mildly amusing. So why wait 45 years to get into stand-up? Because since coming of age and exploding on the London gay scene, I've been drowning 24/7 in gay sex. Ask any man here with homo inclinations. They will confirm I am the gay ideal. Small ears, thin wrists. And if you slide yourself down the length of my desk bed, you can see a kestrel hovering through the window. That's catnip for the gays. Ben Whishaw, Russell Tovey, Tom Daly. They've all climbed the rungs of the deskbed to cop off and cop an eyeful of the kestrel. The queue has been round the block. So after some letters from the council and a rash, I realised two things. One, sex has lost its meaning. And two, the kestrel is a perv. I faced a choice. Become just another gay man, lost in the scramble for sexual gratification. Or transcend the ego in one selfless genius act by putting some lube on my face. I look like a knob. But laughter, Stockwell, itself a form of lubrication, reducing friction between strangers and enhancing communion between us all. Perhaps there will be Max Turner final lovemaking tonight. Alas, I will not be a participant. Because, and please understand, I've snagged a bollock. And I can only have been John Pape. Thank you and good night.
All right. Hey. Cheers. I'm from the north of England. Hey. Calm down. And whenever I come down here, people always try and do my accent back to me. So, for example, if I'm like, oh, you going in the shop? People will be like, I am going to shop Johnny fucking Scranor out. And I'm like, fuck. Get away from me, you horrible northerner. Because as much as southerners think we hate them, we actually hate each other more. We just lie to you about it. Anyone in from Manchester tonight? Yeah. Piss off. See? People always try and do a Mancunian or a Yorkshire accent to me, and I'm actually from Cheshire. And with a name like Gabrielle McPherson from Cheshire, you probably think that I, like, rode four horses all at the same time or got fingered in Waitrose. But I didn't. I rode a dog. And I've never been fingered in Waitrose. There's a lot of stereotypes about the North, and, you know, they're not all true. Like, we don't all love eating pies or drinking cups of tea or being butlers on BBC period dramas. Some of them are true, though. I'll give you that. Some of them are true. Like, I'd never wear a coat on a night out. If I could be made solely of chips, cheese and gravy, so when I looked in the mirror, I finally felt desirable, goddammit, I would. And my dad doesn't know how to show love. But to be fair to him, though, that is because he's a rock that we pulled up from the salt mines in 1972. At Christmas, we just put a tie on him. Nobody even noticed the difference. And we do have Christmas up north, you know? Yeah, we do. Just like you down here. Just like you down here with your electric cars and your 5G. Your Wi-Fi that works in every area. Your shops that stay open after 6 p.m. and your buses that come more than once an hour, and you. You down here. 80% of your banknotes have cocaine on them, you lucky fuckers. So last time I was licking £20 notes, somebody asked me what the biggest animal I thought I could fight was, and I said, you know, an ostrich, because it's a dinosaur. And they said, no, it's not, it's a bird. And I said, shut up, Grandad, you died 7 years ago. Didn't you? Who did we bury? And my granddad does my head in, he does. I mean, it's easier now that he's dead and he's at the bottom of the Irish Sea, but he does my head in. But I didn't hate him, like, you want my enemy. I've got loads of enemies. I've got more enemies than friends, that's just how I like it. Some of my friends are actually my enemies, they just don't know it yet. But I've only got one arch nemesis, like proper arch nemesis. Her name's Emily Crump. We went to high school together and she was pretty and popular and on everyone's top five. And I had bad breath, a moon face, and ran like I was gonna be sick. Her words, not mine. Even her mum bullied me. The couple of times I was ever actually allowed into a house, they'd make me take my shoes off at the door and they'd lock me in the spare room. And her mum would shout up the stairs, is that man-voiced flipper-footed giraffe up there? And I was, obviously, I was locked in. I was there for days, lovely house, sir. One lunchtime, Emily spat in my mashed potato. So I spent the whole of maths just sharpening a pencil and stabbed her in the back of the leg with it. Another time, she set my science coursework on fire with a Bunsen burner, so I locked her in a cupboard and farted through the keyhole. The war between us really came to a head when we were about 18, though. She lied and spread this rumour that I shagged this lad called Harry James, which I hadn't. So I knew I had to get revenge, and I had the ultimate ammunition. We'd heard for years about how her dad was this big shot pilot, but little did she know I'd flown to Alicante the year before. And I'd seen her dad at the airport, but he wasn't flying a plane, was he? Ooh. He was working in duty-free, handing out scent samples of Beyond by David Beckham. So I told everyone. Turned out he was actually living a lie, and his whole family thought he was a pilot. So when Emily's mum found out, she kicked him out of the house with all his belongings. Luckily, they fit into a small bag which weighed less than 10 kg. And they fit into the overhead locker that he kept on top of his car. His car that he lived in for 3 years after that. But just because you work at an airport, don't make you a pilot. Like, just because I make myself sick on a night out doesn't make me a supermodel. I don't come back from the toilet after having a little scream sick and suddenly I'm Kate Moss. Right, cheers, I better go. Nice one, thanks.
Hi, everyone. Hi, so I'm a queer comedian. Thank you. I actually used to be gay, but it all got a little bit too mainstream for me, if I'm perfectly honest. And then Philip Schofield joined. I was like, nah, fuck this. Nah, I'm off. I went in for the rebrand, come out as queer. It's a bit cooler, isn't it? A bit cooler. I actually came out when I was 24 years old. My mum blamed my sexuality on a French exchange trip when I was 15. To be fair to her, I did come back knowing a full dance routine to Abbas Voulez-vous. And I had a taste for cock. I had a little bit of homophobic abuse the other day, But do you know, I know that we've moved on as a society. I know we've moved on as a society because my first response was, oh my God, how retro. I was on my way to a 70s and 80s party. I was like, is this part of the immersive experience? I love it. This bloke was like, you're puff. I was like, Dad. It took me by surprise, it puzzled me, because I don't think I'm that overtly camp in my day-to-day life. I can turn it on if I need something, though. Like attention. Or if I'm accidentally following a woman home at night, and I want her to know that I'm not a threat. Life is a cabaret. It's not creepy, is it? I know that we've integrated as gay since I come out 20 years ago. I get invited to the stag do's now.
No. I went on a stag do 3 weeks ago. It was my cousin Darren. The best man had organised for us to go to an escape room.
Really?
Escape. It was awful. It really was awful. I had a panic attack. Horrible. It was even worse when I realised that wasn't the escape room. That was an all bar one. Straight people. Got to put in the work. I'm a nurse in my day job. A couple of woos, thank you. Like, you guys used to love us 4 years ago. Yeah, you couldn't get enough of us 4 years ago, could you? Now you're just like, could you go back to work, please? My nan needs a new hip. So I'm a nurse. I'm a queer nurse. It kind of makes it okay. It's the straight male nurses that I feel sorry for. They have a very hard time. I actually consider myself an ally. The straight male, they have a hard time. No one fancies them. It's not a sexy profession. It is not a sexy profession. There is no male nurse calendar. No. You know, pictures of empathetic men with a bereaved relative. Off to give an enema. It's not sexy at all. Apparently male nurses give women the ick. I'm sorry, I think the icks may have gone a little bit too far. They have gone too far. I'm actually fearful for the future of the human race. I reckon this is what happened to the dinosaurs. Yeah, they all got the ick, didn't they? Stegosaurus was like, oh my God, have you seen T-Rex's tiny hands? They've gone too far. They've gone too far. And one of my friends was on a date recently. She come back from the date. She's like, nah, to bin him off. I was like, oh, why? She didn't like the way he pronounced chorizo. Apparently he went, chorizo. She was like, he's from Surrey. I was like, ah, that's fair. Another one of my friends binned off a date. She was like, nah, not seeing him again. Why? Oh, apparently he had to use his inhaler after a rigorous shag. What did you want him to do, die? She wanted him to die. So I'm in therapy, working through a lot, obviously. I'm a nurse and a comedian. People pleasing. I am working on being a people pleaser, but it does mean I'm very good at a gangbang. I just want everyone to have a lovely time. Said my libido's on aeroplane mode, so I'll probably just give out snacks. My therapist has told me that I need to go out and make new friends. It's very difficult, because I'm 42 years old. It's very difficult when you're 42 years old. It's easier when you're in your 20s, isn't it? You've all got the same thing in common. Ketamine. When you're 42, it's hard. I have gone to some very dark places. Pottery making. I joined a gay running group. Thank you. It was actually just me chasing two lesbians around Hyde Park. Looked like a fucking hate crime. Nearly got arrested for that one. You've all been absolutely lovely. I've been Chris Ford.
Yeah. So I've been trying to do less illegal shit recently. Like I haven't done cocaine since 2021. Oh, thanks. Time's currently 22:30. It's been about 2 hours. I'm coming down pretty hard. This is going to be hell. Yeah, I'm a 24-hour time guy. That's my ick. Yeah? Well, I feel like that's an ick. If someone was, like, picking you up for a date and they're like, I'll pick you up at 2100, I'd be like, don't ever pick me up, actually. Get back to the barracks, Lieutenant. Thank you for your service. I've been trying to do less illegal shit, though, because I don't like lawyers. Yeah? I think it's genetic, though, because my great-great-great-granddad stole a loaf of bread to feed his family, and he got caught. And his lawyer was like, plead guilty. So he pled guilty. And now I sound like this. G'day. A little bit of penal colony history for you folks. penal. Anyways, It's hard not to do illegal shit, though, because I was raised Catholic, and every year on the Easter bank holiday, I try to celebrate like Jesus would, you know? Like I'd go out to dinner with my friends and get arrested. And then I just show up 3 days later like, I'm still alive, boys. The Last Supper was weird. You know what I mean? Like, Jesus took the fellas to the pub for his last dinner like he was fucking moving to Liverpool for uni. And he gets up and he gives a speech like, all right, here's the deal. Bread and wine. That's me. I'm pretty sure one of you is just trying to kill me. Did anyone do a welfare check on the big JC, you know? Did anyone go up to Jesus and be like, hey, mate, I think you've had enough of your own blood? And he was like, don't be a Judas. He was like, I'm not Judas, I'm Matthew. He was like, it's an expression. It'll make sense in a couple of days. And then Jesus walks away from the conversation and Matthew's like, Jesus Christ. And Jesus is like, what's up? And he's like, nah, it's an expression. It'll make sense in a couple thousand years. Also, Jesus is not a rich man, which means there was at least one regular in the pub just watching the whole shit go down. Like, oh. King of the Jews is on one tonight. Ezekiel, why are they all sitting on the same side of the fucking table? Well, that was one for the art history fans, but... not many in... grow up. I think Jesus was like the first fucked up celebrity, you know? Or a Nepo baby, maybe. I don't know, I think it's a little convenient that the saviour of all humanity also happens to be the boss's son, but that's just me. I think a lot about fucked up celebrities. You guys know Dr. Seuss? Yeah. Well, Dr. Seuss had a wife who was dying of a terminal illness that shares its name with a zodiac sign. And when she was dying of Aquarius, he got himself a mistress. And I think that's bad. I've just never imagined Dr. Seuss speaking any other way but in whimsical rhyme. So imagining him having an affair is kind of weird, you know? Like the nice mistress lady, she comes over. She's like, oh, doctor, I'm here for the affair. And he's like, I've waited all week for a chance to see you. So pop out dem titties, thing one and thing two. I'm sorry about the voice, by the way, gang. I don't have much time to workshop this. When you imagine Dr. Seuss slinging dick, she can sound, however. However you sound. Oh, doctor! But your wife, she's upstairs in bed and she's sick. My wife is bedridden. She won't be a knocking. Let's take this to the couch and I'll bury me cockin'. I feel like I lost you there, madam. I'm sorry about that. What's your name?
Joanne.
Yeah, all right. Fondle the balls. No. Oh, doctor. Can we do that thing I like? I know what you like. My memory's not foggy. I wrote Cat in the Hat, but I know you love doggy. Now, I think that's a nice one because it shows that he listens. And what more can you ask for than a man that listens? All right, listening to that, I'm going to go. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Identify as an anxious bisexual, otherwise known as fancying everyone and being able to speak to no one. Hi, hello, that's me. I'd say the thing that makes me most anxious about being bisexual in general is just coming out. I've been trying to come out to more people at work recently. I told my colleague Jenny that I'd started seeing someone over the Christmas period, and when I came into work on Monday, she was like, oh, Leela, are you still seeing that man from over Christmas? And I was like, oh, Jenny, it's not a man. And she went, oh, sorry, boy. I was like, no, Jenny, that's not the confession. We work in a school. not the one. I say self-identify as an anxious bisexual, but the anxious bit is actually just something that people have started to really boldly assume about me. I got a message from someone who I've met maybe twice not long ago, asking me to get involved with this project. And she was like, hi, Leela, as you're someone who's part of the LGBT community and you suffer with anxiety... I was like, we have not discussed. We haven't talked about that. But I'll go to the GP, I guess. And I did. I went to the GP, and she gave me a pack of beta blockers, which I am unironically too scared to take. I just don't know what's going to happen. I was like, doc, I see your solution, and I raise you a more a problem. checkmate. but when I received that message, I decided that in 2024, what I need to do is work on my confidence, so I can say words like confidence. Putting on that funny voice. That would be nice. And I did what any one of you would do in my position if you're working on your confidence. And I started playing, say it with me, a full contact rugby! Yeah! that's what I'm doing. I started playing rugby. And I'd say what I've learned on my rugby journey so far in the championship division, because I accidentally joined a really good team, is that being pummeled to the ground by people three times your size of a Sunday afternoon actually doesn't do wonders for your confidence. it's more of a I'm scared and this hurts kind of vibe. And that's a vibe I think I've very much got down. I think at the point when strangers are messaging you on Instagram going, hi, you seem gay and scared. Want to be involved in my project? I think you can kind of tick that off the list. But I'm finding the rugby difficult for a number of reasons, mostly because I think you don't just need to be confident to play rugby, you do need to be actively threatening. And I'm finding that difficult in the championship division. the other day, I was playing in my first game, and the woman defending me, she was standing opposite me, and she was being really threatening. Like, she was looking at me in the eyes, and I swear to God, with her eyes, she was saying, I'm gonna fucking kill you in a minute. And I was like, come on, Leela, confidence, like, give something back. And I looked at her, and with my eyes, I said, I'm gonna fucking let you do it. I might even enjoy it, let's be honest. so the rugby is tricky, but it's not just on the pitch that I'm finding the rugby tricky, it's also off the pitch. There's a big drinking culture in rugby, and I'm just not a big drinking gal. But after my first game in the championship division, I had to down my pint in front of my entire team. And it's not that I cried. It's that the fizz got to my eyes. Okay, stop saying that. yeah, I'm not a big drinker, and I'm also not a big drug-er. I think that's what they call it. I've done drugs once by accident. I was thank you. Yeah, deserves a woo. I was 16, and I was at a party. It was just me and one very square friend and a lot of cool people. And this girl was going around with balloons. And I thought, naturally, they were filled with helium. Because I know a good time when I see one. oh, yes, I do. so she got round to me and she sort of looked me up and down and she was like, are you sure you wanna? And I was like, yeah, I've been doing it since I was like three. took it off her, inhaled the entire thing, and then could be heard saying, hello. why's my voice not gone high? got some vodka jelly babies, thought that would help, shoved them in my gob. Started, and then just as I was digesting the vodka jelly babies, I was like, oh, I think I've done some drugs. and at the same time as I was processing that information, I saw a girl in the corner of the room injecting herself in her leg. And I looked over to my square friend and I was like, psst. I think we might be a bit out of our depth here. I think some people are doing some hard drugs. Maybe we should leave. but I didn't realise quite how loud I was talking because of the drugs. And the girl came up to me and was like, "Hi, sorry, just couldn't help overhearing what you said. And just to reassure you, I'm diabetic. it's okay." So sometimes there's a reason to have a lack of confidence. that's my time. Thank you so much. You've been lovely. Good night.
Hi, I'm from Lithuania, the Peterborough of Europe. I moved to UK because I love British culture, I love British people, I love British comedy, but mainly because I couldn't get a green card to the United States. Is anyone affected by the cost of living crisis? Yeah. 10 honest people. Everyone else came to the cheapest comedy show in London for no reason. So because of the cost of living crisis, I got into the hustle hard motivational culture. Started following a lot of these motivational influencers on TikTok and Twitter. So now I wake up every day at 5 in the morning, visualize success, write my affirmations. I plan to change my legal name to Build It Different. Middle name Savage. I don't run from challenges, I invite them into my life. So now I call British Gas every day. And ask them to increase my utility bills. Because that will make me hustle harder. And speaking of cost of living, if I go to a store and see someone shoplifting food, I just pretend that I didn't see it. If I saw someone calling security on the shoplifter, I would call the police on them for being a fucking snitch. It's tough out there, so do what you gotta do to survive. If you need to steal some French fries and olive oil from Lidl to feed your kids, fucking go for it. Take some tiramisu too. Live a little. Do we have any immigrants in the room? So as you know, the government wants to slow down legal immigration by not allowing overseas students to bring their families to live in the UK. And they think that's great. Because just imagine, you learn English as your second language, you study hard, you pass your exams, you go through a tough application process, you get accepted into university, you get your visa, you move out, you're finally free, and then your fucking family comes to live with you. That's an immigration policy that international students always secretly wanted. Now we don't have to think of an excuse of how to say no to their families. Like, I love my family. Well, I like my family. I guess I'm okay with my family. But if he decided to move to UK and come live with me, I would have him deported myself. I don't regret what I just said. Do you guys like shopping online?
Yeah.
Nice, I like it too. I love Amazon. I love Amazon. I love big corporations in general. I do. Because I think small businesses are way too overrated and get too much respect. Like, you go to some small hipster cafe in Camden, you pay £9 for a bad cup of coffee, you get a lecture about climate change from a barista, and you feel guilty for being there. You go to Starbucks, you get exactly what you paid for, and you feel happy. And that's where we, collectively as a society, go, "Wow, Starbucks is so good at what we do. So good at what we do. We should pay less taxes." Like, let's be honest. If your small business was so amazing, it wouldn't be a small business. Would it? It would be a corporation. I think it's even worse when someone says that they are proud of their family-owned small business, when someone goes, "Oh, my family owned this bakery for 3 generations. You shouldn't be proud of that. That just means that your family has failed to grow their business. for three generations. Your family is objectively bad at business. Your family had three generations to make something out of themselves, and we fucked it. If your family was good at business, TV show Succession would be about your family. Anyway, point being, fuck small businesses. Shout out Jeff Bezos. Recently, I actually had a nightmare that I was still living back in Eastern Europe. Was never so happy to wake up, go outside, and see a double stabbing in front of Poundland. Anyway, when I started doing comedy, I never thought that I would be making money from it and dating supermodels. Turns out, I was right. All right, I've been Donato Stanegan, thank you.
Okay. See if there's any energy in the room. How are we doing? Yes! Yes! You know, I love that. I love that response. It's one of the main reasons I love stand-up, you know? It's just so goddamn random! Yeah? What other profession can you ask, how are you? And it's all right to reply, woo! Where? Maybe a crack house? In normal life, you know, you can't do that. You can't do that shit at the office, can you? You can't be standing by the printer. Oh, hi, Sharon. Oh, happy Monday. How are... Whoa! Oh, my God! It's Monday. You know? You get drug tested. Yeah? So it's lovely to be here. My name is Wes. I'm from Essex. Yeah. This is what we look like now. This is what you're getting from Essex now. You know? I know as soon as I say I'm from Essex, I know there's a few people out here looking at me thinking, what? Essex? Well, lip fillers and fake tan have come a long way, haven't they? Basically, it's black. It's like cultural appropriation. It's natural. Yeah, man. Yes, I was actually born in London, but Essex is where I grew up. That's where I went to school. Yes, there are schools. And, you know, I was thinking about school recently. I was thinking that it's crazy. We've all been to completely different schools, I assume. But like, despite that, everyone seems to have had at least a version of this one teacher. Okay, this is the teacher where if you was on your chair and you leaned back, it was as if you were smoking crack. Like, do you remember that teacher? There's always at least one. You're in class, you're bored, you're like, let me lean on my chair. No big deal, right? And at that exact moment, the teacher will disappear from the whiteboard and reappear next to the window. You remind me of a boy I once knew. Timmy, I think it was. Chipper chap, Timmy. Always swinging on that goddamn chair. Reckless. Until one day, he smashed his head on the table. Did he die? He wished. The blunt force trauma made it so he couldn't pass a single exam, which, as we all know, said with me, is the most important thing in life. Yes, children, gold star. He grew up jobless and poor, of course. But things took a turn for the better for Timmy. He met his wife, Sharon. They had three children. They were happy. And then all of a sudden, AIDS. There's nothing funny about AIDS, children. His wife took the kids and the house, and he spent the rest of his days alone. Is that what you want? Huh? Is that what you want? Well, stop swinging on that goddamn chair. And you never believe him. Yeah. You go to your friend, you're like, that story's not real. That story is real. How do you know, sir? Because I'm Timmy! I'm Timmy. Oh, God. Oh, Sharon. Oh, the children. Oh, God. Oh, God.
Sir, are you all right?
Woo! 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 I will say it was a weird day to have Ofsted in, but I don't know what you wrote down, but yeah, man. I'm from Caribbean descent, Bomberclaw, and I am. We got Caribbean parents, you get quite a strict upbringing. You know, anyone else had a strict upbringing growing up? Yeah. Okay, we've got some trauma here, that's nice. It's good to know you're not alone, you know. You ever had it where you accidentally tuck or kiss your teeth at something your parents said and then you realise, oh, my life's on the line now. Yeah. In my room, minding my own business, playing Crash Bandicoot, you know the vibes. Mum will come in with her catchphrase, Wesley, this place is a pigsty. I'm like eight, I'm like, what the fuck is a sty? Get off that game and clean it now. All right, Mum, off to this level. No, I said now. You turn it off or I will. And in that moment, all I could think to do to get myself out of that guaranteed death sentence was I just acted like I was beatboxing the whole time. Just. It's tidy up time. It's tidy up time. It's tidy up time. It's tidy up time. I love my mommy. Yo, I'm Wes Defoe. Thanks for listening. Enjoy the rest of your night.
Wes Defoe!
Hell yeah, folks. How we doing? My name's Zach. A bit about me. I live in London. Not too happy with my current living situation at the moment because the other day I opened the door, my flatmate having a wank. We were both surprised, you know, as would be. And he turned to me and he said, what do you want? And I said, Dad, not in the garden. What are you doing? But folks, I'm from East London. Now, a lot of people don't believe me when I say that. And it's because I look, dress, and sound like someone who moved to this city and made it shit, okay? Even last week, bro, I got into an argument with this guy, right? And at the end of it, he turned to me and he went, why don't you just fuck off back to Oxford, you hipster prick, right? And I mean, fair play, I probably deserve that. But it's like I said to him, bro, if you leave your wheelchair unattended, I'm gonna have a go. Do you know what I mean? Don't leave your wheelchair lying around and be surprised to me coming back to do like tricks on it. You know what I mean? On your feet, lose your seat. That's how it works, right, folks? You know, London's changed a lot since I was growing up. So I remember, like, when I was younger, my mum, she stopped me from going to Hackney because on two separate occasions that I went to Hackney, right, I got robbed. Okay. Fast forward 10 years to now gentrified Hackney, where coffee is £9, folks. I'm still getting fucking robbed in Hackney. Okay. The only difference is now the person robbing me is a Tory with a card machine, you know? But, you know, it was character building growing up in London. And by that, I, of course, mean not a safe environment for children at all. But, you know, I learned to live with it. Because, folks, let's be honest, London is a place where we know deep down, truly, no one gives a fuck about you. Do you know what I mean? You get hit by a car here and it's your fault somehow, you know? Because what are you standing on the pavement for, like a dickhead? Yeah. Bro, London is the one place in the world where you get stabbed, right? You could be bleeding, dying on the floor, and if you ask someone for help, they'd just say, sorry, mate, I haven't got any change. But being around this so much, right, it kind of starts to get to you eventually, you know? I'll give you start to become very sort of untrusting, very suspicious of people, even when they're just trying to be nice to you. I'll give you an example of this, okay? The other day, I was in an Uber, right? And I sat down, and before we'd even set off, the driver turned to me and he went, thank you for choosing to ride with me today. I really appreciate it. I hope you enjoy your journey, right? And I thought, this guy is gonna fuck the car off a bridge, bro. Who starts an Uber journey like that? Do you know what I mean? What the fuck, bro? It's not how this is supposed to go. How this is supposed to go is I sit down, ask you if you've been busy. You say, not really, right? Okay? We do the journey in silence. And I give you 5 stars, that's how it works. Not that fucking American Psycho shit you just pulled on me there. Do you know what I mean? It's the same as this, folks. Imagine, right, you'd ordered food off Deliveroo, okay? And your driver texts you and he says, hey, I'm on the way, hope you enjoy your food. Why? What the fuck did you do to it, bro? Next thing you know, I'm on support saying, yeah, I can't be too sure, but I think my driver's cum in my food, you know? But this has gotten to like every facet of my life now, right? I live in a flat, right? I live on the third floor, and I have an intercom to answer the flat now. Just how I am, when people buzz my flat, I treat it like a massive inconvenience every time, right? My friends say that when I answer the intercom, I sound like they've just interrupted me having a wank, right? Just very lethargic, what do you want, right? But it's for good reason, this, right? So the other day, someone buzzed my flat and answered, and it was a woman outside, and she goes, "Hello, we're from Battersea Dogs Home. We're speaking to animal lovers in the area. Are you an animal lover?" And I thought, first of all, what I do with my dog is none of your business, right? But folks, I live in Lewisham, right? So I said to her, I was like, "We're about an hour away from Battersea. Like, what are you doing around here? Why are you here?" And she went silent, right? She didn't answer me. And I went, "Are you lot fucking Jehovah's Witnesses?" And she went, "Yeah." They're getting smart, folks. Don't fall for it. I almost fell for that dog shit, bro. Honestly, I had my dog next to me. I was looking at her like, "Who the fuck have you been speaking to?" Do you know what I mean? After everything I've done for you, Childline, you know? Anyway, I'll leave you on this final thought. Do you not think, or do you not find it quite ironic that people who complain about finding hair in their food will complain about that, but what they will not complain about is eating someone's ass, you know? I mean, I'm not saying I'm better than those people, but I don't complain about hair in my food, you know? Anyway, folks, you've been wonderful. I've been Zach Ranger. Thank you.
Hello, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Cavendish. My name is Jordan. I've got to introduce myself. My name is Jordan. I'm from South London. So I'm from this area, and I come from a very mixed family, guys. I've got to tell you, I come from a very mixed family. So my mother is black. She's from Kingston, Jamaica. My dad is Punjabi Indian. He's a Sikh. I have a stepfather who's from Nigeria. And I have a little sister who's my stepfather and my mother's child. So she's half Nigerian, half Jamaican. That makes her Italian, ladies and gentlemen. That's how multicultural my family is. She doesn't like it when I tell that joke, though. She's always like, "Why are you always telling this joke about me? And why are you always use a stereotypical accent?" Another thing about me, guys, I recently turned 30. Give me a cheer for that. Come on, man. I'm 30 years old. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And I want to be a better person, so I'm trying to sort out my health, man. So I said I want to go to the gym more. So I was working out at the gym the other day, and I'm working out pretty hard, you know, I'm good. And then a PT comes over. We all have had an issue with a PT. And a PT comes over, he sees me train, he says, "Yo, big man, I see you're training hard, bruv. I see you're training hard, but you got no routine. You need to train with me, bruv. Train with me and I'll get you girls. Look at you, I bet you get no girls. Train with me, I'll get you girls." That's how he got me. I was like, "It's true, I don't get girls, it's true. I don't want to train with you." So I trained with him, man. I was training with him. I was looking good. I was like a Rocky montage, bruv. Me and him look good. He's so big, bruv. He looked like eight the previous client. I knew I was in good hands with him, man. I was working out, doing well and everything, right? And then next thing, he comes up to me, says, "Yo, bro, you see, you're training good, bruv. Next week, yeah, let's set up a payment plan, yeah? We'll carry on and do it until you're in tip-top shape, yeah?" I was like, I realized cost of living crisis. I can't afford a PT. So every time this guy comes in the gym, I'm just avoiding him, man. Like, when he's at the treadmill, I go to the squat racks. When he's at the squat racks, I go to the bench press. When he's at the bench press, I go to the spin machine. Turns out, just avoiding this guy, I lost 2 stone. That's how you do it. I want to take care of my mental health as well, right? So I want to take care of my mental health. And I saw this video online that said, it asked men, "Do you tell other men that you love them, your male friends that you love them? Do you tell your male friends that you love them, right?" And it made me thinking, you know, about this. And I want to ask, you know, if you've got some men, do you tell your male friends you love them?
Yeah.
Yeah? You?
Yeah.
Yeah? Do you? You're like, yeah. You know. You're like, nah. They tell me they love me. You're like, nah, I don't tell anyone they love me, man. For me, I don't. But I said, I'll do something new, right? So I sent a message to my friends. I was like, "You know what? I love you, bro." Right? Next thing I got bear messages like, "Hey, bruv, don't kill yourself." I know the comedy thing ain't going well. But you need to persevere, bruv. I got another message saying, "Bruv, I know you're not good looking, yeah? Right? But you got the personality, bruv. You got the personality. You just gotta carry on, man." I got another message saying, "Bruv, I know you don't get no gal, yeah? That's why you need to sign up to the payment plan I've been telling you about, bruv." I classic sent it to the PT, man. Another thing, guys, I need to ask if people can relate to this. I'm in a WhatsApp group and I want to leave. Can anyone give me a cheer if you're in the same position as me? It's like the same WhatsApp group. You're just like, I'm scared to leave, man. So I'm in this WhatsApp group, and I've been there for a while now. I've been there, stuck in this place for 5 years. It was made for a noble purpose. My friend got in an accident, made a WhatsApp group to update us what happened to him. Very grateful, but it's 5 years. I don't like these people in the group chat. They're NPCs. I don't care about their life. They're very basic, right? And I want to leave, right? But I don't want to leave. I don't want to be the first one, yeah? So I'm trying to do stuff to get kicked out, yeah? Right, so I'm just in the group chat, like, sending pyramid schemes to them. Didn't work, man. They signed up for it. I made 25 quid, but they didn't kick me out, man. They didn't kick me out. But you know when you're in a group chat and there's that one other person that's just silent all the time, like, never messages. Yeah. So I said, you know what, I'm gonna reach out to this guy. I bet he don't wanna be in the air, bro. So I messaged him and say, yo, bro, I wanna get out of the group chat, man. Like, are you up for it? He's like, I'm up for it, man. I thought I was just waiting for the opportunity. I was like, good. Then he was telling me, yeah, but there's someone else in the group chat that wants to leave too. So can we make a chat for that, right? So I was like, okay, add them. Then that person told me that someone else wants to leave as well at that group chat. And eventually, everyone left the group chat to join this group chat except the person that we joined before. And I'm stuck again, right? So I'm stuck to what to do. So I'm thinking of just snitching on them to the main guy. But I'm stuck there to do that. But yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. I'm like the group chat. I'm leaving the stage. Thank you very much. I've been Jordan Gill.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jordan Gill.
Thank you very much. It's lovely to be here. My name's Ronan. I'm a massive gay. Massive gay that was raised Roman Catholic, and I think the church made me gay. I do. Every week, I was on my knees begging for forgiveness from a statue of a virtually naked man who is in phenomenal shape. No, he is. He's gorgeous. He's got the type of body that you look at and go, Jesus Christ! They could have chosen any man in a teeny tiny towel. Gollum would have kept me straight. But they went for biblical Joe Wicks, didn't they? I think the Bible is a book by the gays, for the gays. It's just been interpreted completely wrong. I'll give you some examples. Matthew, 25 to 28. Mark, 18 to 32. Luke, 25 to 28. And John, 18 to 24. I mean, the New Testament is literally just those four passing around notes about this really great guy that I've met, who's so amazing and can, like, literally turn water into Chardonnay. They did a brunch where they discussed his body, bread, and carbs. That is a Clapham Gay Saturday morning. There's also the Old Testament. Oh, there is a lovely quote in the Old Testament. Do not practice homosexuality. Lovely quote. Now, when you read that on the page, it does come across as they do not want us to practice homosexuality. But I think what they're actually trying to say here, they want us to go professional. No, they do. They don't want us to practice the sport. They want us to master the sport. They love the gays. The church, they bloody love the gays. Look at what they do to gay people. If you're gay, you're going straight to hell, where it will be hot. And it will be sweaty. And every gay man that's ever existed will be there. And you will be punished. Don't threaten me with a good time. Oh, man. I'm also epileptic. I'm epileptic. If I have a seizure, apparently you're supposed to call an ambulance, which I think is a bit silly. Ooh, let's drive the big box of flashing lights towards the epileptic. That's what he needs right now, isn't it? I have to have regular check-ins with my neurologist, and in a recent one, he asked me if I was in a relationship. I said no, and he goes, okay, well, if you start having more seizures, We are going to have to get you a bed partner.
Apparently, that's for my safety. Someone to watch me in the night to make sure I don't hurt myself. All I heard was the NHS looking at me going, "You're so single, we're going to have to prescribe somebody to sleep with you." He also gave me a list of things that I can't do anymore now that I'm epileptic. So I can't swim, I can't drive. And then he goes, "You also can't be left alone with children anymore." Now, bear with me on this one, because it does actually make sense. I could be looking after a child, I have a seizure, they're left unattended, and they could hurt themselves. But then he goes, "You do need to make people aware of that one. But you don't need to disclose the reason why if you're not comfortable in doing so." I said, "Mr. Neurologist, I would love to know who's going around telling people they can't be left alone with children and then choosing not to follow up with the epileptic stuff." I'm in between jobs at the moment. I had a job interview last week for TikTok. And I went into the interview and I asked them what the role was. She went, "Here at TikTok, we don't believe in job titles." I said, "Okay, in which case, how do you determine people's salaries then?" She went, "Here at TikTok, your salary is determined by the vibe you give off in the room." The vibe you give off in the room. I had 4 rounds of interviews and eventually was offered a job with a salary of £23,000. Now, the London living salary is £25,000, which means I sat down with 4 strangers who collectively agreed that my personality wasn't enough to be kept alive. My personality has been very mediocre, but you have been fantastic. Thank you for having me. Cheers.
Thank you.
Come on, make some noise. It's Ronan McCabe. Give a round of applause. Come on.
So despite appearances, I've never actually shouted the word bosh after an orgasm. I've never sold anyone a pound of bananas. Never voted for UKIP. Although my name is Scott Smith and my initials don't actually help me out with that one, I'll be honest with you. I recently took a DNA test. Turns out I'm 34% black cab driver. I grew up on a rough council estate, so rough that I lost my virginity before both my parents actually did. I was always jealous of my friends growing up because we had nothing. My friends were richer than I was, especially around Christmas time. One of them would get a computer, another one would get a bike. I'd get a stepdad. Imagine my little face on Christmas. I come running down the stairs. "Is it an Xbox? Is it a PlayStation? It's fucking Brian." I don't know if you've ever unwrapped an adult as a child. It's really embarrassing. I am a single parent. Raised both my kids on my own for the last 12 years. No. Don't woo me. I've done a terrible job. They are fucking animals. It's very unusual for people's parents to still be together. Is there anyone here, parents still together? Oh, yeah? How long have your parents been together?
23 years.
23 years? Yeah. Fuck it, they've definitely had anal. I don't want to spoil your Sunday roast dinner, but when you're sitting there with your mum and dad next time, it will go through your brain. You'll look at them both like, they definitely have tried it at least. Kids can say some horrible things. You know what? When my kids upset me, it flusters me and I get all my words wrong. And I said to my kid, I said, "Get upstairs and brush your teeth because your dog smells like breath shit." And I'm thinking, please don't have heard me. And he did, he heard me. He was going, "Dad got it wrong, Dad got it wrong." I was like, "Oh yeah, I've seen your mum's tits." I got dragged into the headmaster's office, right? She said, "Sit down, Mr. Smith. Your son's had an altercation with another student." And this other student had lost both his parents in a car crash a couple of months previous. And after threatening your son with violence, your son retaliated by saying, "Just because you're an orphan doesn't qualify you as fucking Batman." I have never been so proud as an adult. I have to sit there and she goes, that's not funny, is it? I'm like, yeah, it's pretty fucking funny, actually, yeah. She said, look, we know your son. We know he can be a bit of a joker. I said, you can't throw two Batman references at me and expect me not to do anything with that. I got to admit, I did go down the slightly childish route of saying to her, listen, I know my kid, and I can assure you that he didn't mean it. I got him suspended for 3 days. Anyone here got any tattoos? Yeah, I've got tattoos. Look how shit those are. My arm would look great on a beach in Marbella in 1997. The reason I don't like my tattoos is because every tattoo needs a story behind it these days. And I've got to lie, people come up to me and go, why'd you get that done? And I go, I fucking loved zebras when I was a kid. Anyone got tattoos of animals? No, listen, it's fine if you do. I just don't understand when people have tattoos of animals, because I guarantee you there's not an elephant out in Thailand that's got a tattoo on its arse of a crusty student on a gap year. There's no lion out in Africa that's got a tattoo on its arm of a bloke with an England top on down in a pint. And I can promise you this now, there is no butterfly out that has got a tattoo of a fat cancer state bird on its shoulder. They're out there. Deal with it. This is my impression of a butterfly. What's that? That's my new tattoo. That is beautiful, that is, isn't it? Yes, it is, because although I'm a delicate, beautiful butterfly, my spirit human is a fat bird in pyjamas smoking a spliff. You've got to excuse me, I have got this cough at the moment, and it's a violent cough. And as I'm 45, I never realised that if I coughed violently, I might also have to clench in case I shit my pants. I coughed so hard in my car the other day, I'm not joking, if you looked at my face, it was like I was doing maths. I was like, ugh. I think I might need a tissue. That's been about my 5 minutes. Listen, thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
All right. I'm John. I do bird comedy. That's comedy about birds. This is what happens when a penguin becomes too powerful. This is what happens if you put a swan in a washing machine with a red sock. This is what happens if you crossbreed a seagull with a shuttlecock. I'm sort of like David Attenborough, but no one will be sad when I die. Next, we've got this guy. This is the horn screamer. Only bird in the world to have a horn on its head, but no one knows what the horn is for. Story of my life. They don't use it as a weapon. They don't use it to impress girls. Same. My theory is they just absolutely love kebabs. Next, we've got this thieving bastard. The collective noun for a group of magpies is a crime syndicate. You're not meant to give ducks bread anymore, so I just give them lasagna. Next, we've got a turkey. Very ugly bird, turkey. It looks like a scrotum with every STD at once. Or just, I am aware that standing here with all these sheets of paper does make me look like the creep from Love Actually. Oh, you know, I prefer Dove, actually. Come on, don't clap that. You're better than that. They say a pigeon is just a rat with wings. I say a seagull is just a feathery cunt. Now, stay with me here. This is what a British city looks like. This is what a foreign city looks like. This is what a British beach looks like. This is what a foreign beach looks like. You see where this is going? This is what a British pigeon looks like. And this is what a foreign pigeon looks like. Are you fucking kidding me? We spent 500 years going around the world stealing shit. Could we not have stolen a better pigeon? Like, give the Greeks their marbles back if we get one of these. Or these, or Well, fucking hell. Or wait for it. Or these. Unbelievable. Oh, by the way, that was a cat among the pigeons. This is a turquoise-browed mot-mot. As you can see, it's a small, colourful bird with a pair of darts shoved up its arse. This is a bird where absolutely everything has gone wrong. I mean, you don't get swimless fish, do you? The ostrich is so messed up, its eyes are bigger than its brain. Its eyes are the size of snooker balls, and they're brown, which means they're worth 4 points. Next, we've got this Tory. If a swan was any more right-wing, it would only be able to fly in a circle. This is a cuckoo. Any bird that gets into bed with the alarm clock industry can get fucked. The only thing more American than a bald eagle would be if a Statue of Liberty shot up a McDonald's. This is a hoopoe, and he's a little freak. He shits in his own nest to stop predators stealing his eggs. Sounds disgusting, but it does work. So, you know, if you're thinking of mugging me after the show, just be aware, I have done a poo in my wallet. Do you know how difficult it is to research this bird? You Google tits, you get porn. You Google great tits, you get better porn. You Google blue tits, you get avatar porn. This is a kingfisher, very streamlined bird, the kingfisher. It can dive into water without making a sound. In fact, it's so streamlined, Japanese engineers based the design of a bullet train off the shape of its beak. As you can see, they got it absolutely spot on. Much more streamlined than the choo-choo toucan. And don't even get me started on the rail replacement bustard. Right, one last bird. Final bird. This bird is a shag. And now look, I've been an avid bird watcher all my life. And in my experience, a shag is very rare. Thank you.